This next item on the agenda, the first public hearing item, was tabled during the October 7th meeting. So I will need a motion to remove this item from the table before we begin discussion. Motion is second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, the same sign. Okay, Matt, you can proceed.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mayor. As you said, this is an agenda item from 2 weeks ago that was tabled. No need to go through all of the details of the request. We went through all of that 2 weeks ago, but as a quick reminder and refresher, this is a request for a conditional use permit that has been submitted by some fellow charter academy. This is a property out on East Park Avenue, almost 70 acres worth. It's currently zoned residential R10. They are requesting conditional use approval for a charter school on that property. This is in the neighborhood activity center area and conference plan. We have the other maps and arrow in the packet, as well as the proposed site plan. I want to call to your attention on page 4 of your agenda packet. It's actually beginning at the bottom of page 3 is the listing of the conditional use review criteria. As we talked about before, and as a reminder, this is a land use decision type of case. It is not a rezoning, but it is a land use decision within a particular zoning district. Anything that may get approved has to go through the full development review and permitting process, and subject to numerous different types of rules and regulations that would be applicable to any development on this property. But these criteria, I'm going to just read through them just to get them fresh in our minds. Whether or not the proposed use is consistent with all the requirements of the zoning district in which it is located, including the required parking, loading areas, setbacks, and transitional buffers. The second one is compatibility of the proposed use with land use on adjacent properties, including the size, scale, and massing of buildings and lots. The third is adequacy of the ingress and egress to the subject property and to all proposed buildings, structures, and uses thereon, including the traffic impact of the proposed use on the capacity and safety of public streets, providing access to the subject site. The fourth is adequacy of other public facilities and services, including stormwater management, schools, parks, sidewalks, and utilities to serve the proposed use. Number 5 is whether or not the proposed use will create adverse impacts on any adjacent or nearby properties by reason of noise, smoke, odor, dust, or vibration, or by the character and volume of traffic generated by the proposed use. Number 6 is whether or not the proposed use will create adverse impacts upon any adjoining land uses by reason of the manner or operation or hours of operation of the proposed use. And then lastly, whether or not the proposed use will create adverse impacts on any environmentally sensitive areas or natural resources, such as wetlands, floodplains, etc. These are criteria directly out of the city's land development regulations, zoning ordinance. They are reviewed and used as part of staff's basis when they prepare on report and recommendation. Staff and the planning commission have answered affirmatively to all 7 of these. And as we talked about 2 weeks ago, the planning commission reviewed this. They found it consistent with our comprehensive plan, the standards, and then recommending approval unanimously with the conditions that are there outlined in your packet and that we talked about 2 weeks ago. Any additional questions on this one?
Does anyone from council have any questions for Matt?
But in reviewing this, I'm glad we had a little more time to look over. In the conditional use review criteria, I think it's section 3AB. It's number 3, it says adequate of ingress and egress to the subject property and to all old building structures and uses thereon, including the traffic impact of the proposed use of the capacity and safe for public streets providing access to the subject site. And after they put a yes, we put that it is not designed straight out in the more sufficient space for on-site parks, parking, as well as student drop-off. Extravagant access will be from a new proposed electric
master plan for the city to extend Northside Drive through the subject property to East Park Avenue. The site plan in your packet and also on the screen, you see a representation of that along the south side of this property. That sort of function is their main entrance. And then later, once it is fully extended, it will become an extension of Northside Drive.
What's the timeline?
It is scheduled in the current version of the master plan to be after the year 2021. The completion of it, it's actually a contract of 2021 to 2025.
Now, I'm assuming my material is all kept.
Yeah, correct. That's the main road. It's formerly a state highway. And you also see that, of course, there on the area on the maps and the site plan.
Now, the school is supposed to be able to operate with this per year, right?
They are wanting to be operational next fall.
And that is it correct that the first phase of that road they would build, so that appears to show a drawing, an extension of the portion of that road, so the school.
Correct. They would use that as their driveway entrance, but to become a future roadway. Just in the early years, it would connect only to their property.
Well, maybe when you look at that Northside Drive, trying to get that bumped over, so I'm afraid there is going to be a collective road that's shown only that we have a collective road.
Well, that is a project that is was looked at as a long range, but it was not really anything to drive a project. Typically, there's not a demand for it. And so it was intended as this, all this property and wayland developed, and that would help relieve, spread out, manage traffic. And so essentially, what they're doing is putting in the first phase, the first piece of that road right now, that would just serve the school. I understand that in the future, it would be extended back around the J.C. Chapman Road.
That's correct.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a public hearing item. Each side of for and against will be given each 15 minutes for each side, not 15 minutes per person, but 15 minutes for each side. So, saying that, is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak for this request?
Bill, I get what I was doing. Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I appreciate being here today. I represent still Charter Academy in this request on additional use of elementary school in our town. We've got people that charge, but we work on an hourly basis, but sometimes we talk faster than an hour.
No, ma'am.
This, you know, in all zoning considerations, you know, we, like all our home pharmacies, have zoning regulations that govern when and how we can develop. And originally, and I had asked somebody earlier, when did we pass it? I don't know when I first started about the law. Lowndes County didn't have zoning. And I think that was in the late 70s that they passed. And I think that lost the bay and then after their zoning. 60s, if I'm not mistaken, late 60s. But prior to that, an individual could use the property any way he wanted to. So, you know, zoning is a derogation from common law. So, you start off with the premise somebody should be able to use their property in any reasonable way, unless it's a public purpose that it be restricted in some way. And all of that acted a very comprehensive and thorough zoning ordinance to protect the landlord and to protect the public. And in that, you have a conditional use. You know, when we come down or when an applicant comes down to file a request of conditional use, they're given this application. And on the application provides some standards for exercising that zoning law. And as you go through, and I'm not going to bore you, go through every one of them, I would like to mention a go through those same standards, we unequivocally answer all of them in the affirmative, that we do not create any adverse impact on the city's infrastructure or the neighboring property. And even, and you know, the way I take 12 minutes, I... I would have said before that, but if you ask me my watch, I keep it in my office. Anyway, when you look at it, and you don't do the same thing. You don't have a very comprehensive plan where the application comes in, and you have a very able staff that reviews it and answers the same questions that we did. That we answered when we filed our application. They found every one of them that we did not adversely affect, which means that we should be qualified for conditional use. And that's supposed to be the determination. Now, and then it goes to your departments, and you only go one step up, and even your departments found that it would create any adverse impact. And then it goes to the planning commission, which you know there's a cross-section of this community. And as Sonny can tell you, the many years that I've been coming up here, I never get to come up here, but it's a unanimous decision from the planning commission. And a cross-section of, you've got 11 members, I think, maybe the chairman of Sonny's, and you've got, I think, Asher may not have a number. Now, anyway, it was 9 in favor of this, with no abstentions or anything else. There are 4 conditions on their approval, and we accept those conditions as being reasonable. But they found that the criteria for granting a conditional use was all complied with, and there was no adverse impact. I want to mention a couple of them, because I think that this even goes further than not having any adverse impact, but I think it benefits the city, and I think your staff and your departments that realize that. As you look at the ingress egress that Councilman Wright mentioned, well, you have a portion of Northside Road that's being paid for by the school. You've got, and I understand the school has agreed to contribute land for that purpose, which means you don't have to go out either by the pandemic. So, I mean, so not only is it doesn't create an adverse impact, it's a benefit to you as a city councilman and you as the stewards of the public money that you look after this city. If you, and that was number 3, James, that you mentioned. Now, you say, well, when will Northside be extended? I'm sure that this body will extend it when it's needed. But if you look at the arterial of the Sarah Lakeland Highway, isn't that still a state highway? Is it?
Only the portion of
outside of perimeter. Okay. You don't have the 3,732 cars a day on average. That's per day. That's one of the lowest counts you'll see on one of our main roads. If you look, and an engineer will tell you that our highways, a two-lane highway like that, will accommodate up to 10 times that. It's certainly, even if you don't want any congestion, 10,000 would be the lowest number. Well, you know, you're 3 times less than the lowest congestion that you ever consider. It probably, and I imagine as you look at when you're going to extend the whole side, I know there are many considerations, but it's probably not necessary right now. But it's something that I agree with. Council on that probably ought to be pushed up on the agenda, but it's not necessary for this community or this development. That's not a reason to deny this request. I would like to call your attention to the 4th consideration, which deals with the water and sewer. You know, a number of years ago, and y'all took in certain islands with a promise that you would extend water and sewer. Water and sewer is being extended. I understand a plan to be there, and I guess you correct me if I'm wrong. Now, the Lakeland Highway, the community where Lonesome Dove is that correct?
I believe that's how it's been ordered.
Well, extending the water and sewer with this development, in my computation, some 2,100 feet, should save the city $200,000. So, I mean, that's another example how not only is this development good and entitled to additional use, it saves you money that you can use it on something else. One of the many demands that you have. Again, I encourage you to look at the conditions with which or on which you base your decision, and I think you'll find that all of these, this request has no adverse impact. I want to mention one other thing. People always microwave loves. It makes us look good down the line. But seriously, I wrote a letter. I don't want any, and nobody likes to get a letter from a lawyer. I don't even like to get a letter from a fellow lawyer, but, that's just what we have to do. And I wrote a letter to the city in this case, but when I looked at it, to me, this is a very clear case. To me, that we satisfy all the conditions. To me, the way I read the law, I feel like being exempt. Having to go to zoning. I readily admit that two sides should, but to me, we were exempt from it. We're here today because that was the position that we need to get through this request, but the law puts a burden on me that I have to put something in writing on the record. If I don't, then I'm not going to sit in the client. So, if some of you don't like getting a lot of some lawyer, or you get one with the city indirectly, and then you don't. Hold it against me, not my client. Because I'm doing what I have to do. And it's not that personal any other way, it's just something I need to do. I hope that I had a concern that there was some consideration that possibly the concern with this particular request didn't stem from land use, but possibly may extend to the applicant itself and primary charter schools. That's just not the test for land use. When you exercise the rights the law is vested in you, you have to operate on land use. And the basis of land use are those seven criteria. You can't discriminate on the applicant because you like or don't like the applicant, either for or against. That's just not the basis of the decision. Now, I'm going to ask Julie, and I'm going to take all the mental time, so I better hurry. I'm going to ask Julie to just tell you a little bit about charter schools. I would hope you'd give us maybe a little bit more than 15 minutes. Apparently, I'm not talking fast enough. I see the mayor change the trick and say it. I asked, and you sound fast, I'm getting out. I seriously ask that y'all look at the criteria. Please judge us by those seven criteria. That's all we ask. Apply the ordinance that you pass. We complied with it when we filed. We complied with it when we came up here. We complied with it. We went through every step of this process. We ask that you be fair to us and judge us by the same standard. Thank you very much. I'll be happy to answer questions.
It appears to me that you all act as we have heard this now, and that you are appealing it. You all been advised on we vote with the end of the draw. Then accusations come at that process. We all assume what is going to happen, but we never took a vote.
Yes, sir. I understood that now.
But it comes across. You asked some questions. And it's the first time in my 26 years, that something gets withdrawn because council members engaged in a robust conversation about what that fact is going to happen.
Any other questions? If not, I would have to see that the case for me in that direction. Thank you. I would love for you to be able to talk to them as you could.
She's going to have 4 minutes and 7 seconds. You've taken some of her time.
Julie Myers, 23 Crestwood West, the Austin, Georgia, 31602. Good evening, Mayor, Council members. Again, thank you for having us here this evening. Just a quick recap on what Scintilla Charter Academy will bring to this community. I am a founding principal. It is going to be a school that Yes, our target area are the high poverty students. Research has shown that high poverty students perform better in a school that is small, intimate. We'll have 20 students per class, 4 teachers per grade, very hands-on, very innovative. We'll have extended day, 7:30 to 4:30. So traffic won't be an issue in the afternoon because we'll be letting out later than the regular schools do into the Austin and Dallas area. It is public, anyone can attend. It is not a magnet school, it is not by application. If our enrollment does go over during the enrollment period, then we will go to a blind lobby system. But again, St. Tillichard Academy will bring a place where teachers can teach without all the red tape, students can learn. It will be electrifying, it will be passionate. It will meet the needs of not all students, but some students. And at the end of the day, that's what a parent deserves, is the right to send their child to a school that's going to fill the needs of that child. And at this time, I have Jeremy speak, please.
Good afternoon, councilmen, councilwomen. My name is Jeremy Baker. I'm a local attorney in town. Not as seasoned as Mr. Langdale, but hopefully one day I'll get there. I serve as the vice chairman of the board, and as the board, it's our responsibility to make sure we follow through with our mission. And you might ask, what is our mission? Our mission is to serve those kids, give those kids an opportunity that, as Julie mentioned, is underserved and underperforming. That's our mission. I understand we're here today for a zoning issue. I just want to give some additional information to the councilmen and councilwomen that serve this distinguished city. With that being said, it's the board's responsibility to make sure we follow through with our mission. And our mission is to serve those kids that both are in poverty areas. We do believe in Julie. We believe in our mission. And we believe in our board as well. I'm here to say, to tell all you all that we will all do with our stated goals and our mission when we serve all kids in poverty area, no matter what their race, color, or creed may be. Our goal is to serve those kids that may not get the attention they need in a big setting. We might have small, intimate settings. I do thank you for your time, and I thank you for our consideration today for the zoning issue.
Thank you, Jim. Is anyone else who would like to take a minute to speak in favor of this request? Anyone who would like to speak in favor of this request? All right, seeing none. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak in opposition to this request? Anyone who would like to speak in opposition? Okay. All right, in that case, council. You've heard you had plenty of time to study this, so this time I'll turn it over to you guys. We have a motion to grant request to grant the request for the conditional use permit. Is there any further discussion?
Yes. Just a couple more quick questions, though. Mr. Langdale, Mr. Harris, I don't know who to answer. How would children transport to and from school, that we have to be personally vehicles or the public transportation, how would they get to and from school?
Can I ask
for
that?
Yes.
Depending on how long it is.
The Victoria Charter Schools, they do not provide their own transportation just because they're on a tighter budget. That's until we will not provide transportation. However, we have gone out into the community. I have had a pastor already commit into that we can use his church vans during the week since they won't be used. I have support letters from parents, from teachers stating that they will be willing to go pick up the students. I don't have children, I will go pick them up. We have other parents that said they would arrange carpools. So if there is a family that wants to come to a Cintilla and that does not have transportation, that is not going to be a barrier.
Mayor, and that's one more question, questions here. You stated something that I wasn't really sure on, that is the selection of your students. I heard you use the term blind lobby system. Is that how all the schools are spread?
Yes, that's how it works in the charter school system.
All the schools spread by line of...
Well, let's just say the first year, we have 80 slots in kindergarten. And 100 students register, then they just all go in half and we...
All the 100?
Yes, all of the 100. It's on first come, first served. You don't have to line up at 3:00 in the morning and wrap around the school to register. So we will do computer registering, and then we'll also go into the communities. And if I can knock on doors, I'll knock on doors.
So if those aren't in the computer, how would any of this head to problem, right?
We will go into the communities, set up at the Milford Under Center, go down. It will happen. They have to knock on 500 doors, I'll knock on 500 doors, and so will the county teacher, so. And if you will look at our Facebook page and our webpage, you'll see the outreach that we've done in those communities. And then we will continue to do that outreach. Any other questions?
Anybody?
Thank you.
Right.
You know, it's fortunate that we did have a chance to vote just because my initial offer, I think that most of us is a media reaction. But you know, I have to bring up about it, I'm really considering. I agree with one thing that Sarah said that really kind of struck me, and I had thought that earlier, that every child should have a choice as to whether they go to school.
Amen.
And without this, there is no choice. So with that, you know, I'm going to support the things, but I still have concerns about this collector and this, because it's in our backyard, that there should be a way to collect it, where this is done. So we need to look at Northside Drive and get that on the agenda.
Bring that up at the retreat. All right, any further discussion? Mayor, is that motion include the conditions? Certification saying? I'm sure I heard it right.
Yes. Yeah. If the motion, your motion included the four.
Well, it was approved the recommendation, which is really
important. Yeah. Right. All right. Okay, in that case, all right, the motion is to approve the conditional use permit. So at this time, all in favor of approval, please raise your right hand. All opposed, by the same sign, motion carries 6-1. Thank you so much.